Yes, and my apologies. This is a bit... Can you still hear me if I don't stand on my tiptoes?
Can we get a chair for Dee, please?
As long as you can still hear me, I'll just do this. My apologies to those of you who were at the Marine Energy Programme Board meeting with Amber Rudd a couple of weeks ago, because I'm basically going to do the same presentation.
We can't see the slides this time, so that'll be...
Well, fun. Yeah, I'll have to explain them all the way through. So I'm the Wave and Tidal Development Manager at RenewableUK, the trade association for wind, wave and tidal energy across the UK. And I've been working very closely with the Marine Energy Programme Board, which is chaired by Amber Rudd, and their economic benefits subgroup, which has been looking at what is the capability of the UK supply chain with regards to marine energy, and also how can we capitalise on that and get the most out of the industry as it starts to grow. So I don't know if you can see this, so I'll explain it in a word form. So we looked at how much investment that already had been in the wave and tidal sectors for those companies that are working in the UK. And we found in a survey earlier this year that over 578 million has been spent by companies working in the UK. And the vast majority of that has been spent within the UK supply chain, about 450 million. Which we think is fantastic and something that we'd like to see continue as the industry starts to grow. We actually wanted to understand how much of that money had come from private sources as opposed to public investment. And although kind of public investment has leveraged private investment through the infrastructure projects that are available, through the test facilities that we have, and also through direct grants, the companies that we surveyed had actually raised around £7 of private investment for each £1 of public money that they'd received, which we'd like to see that continue and get even bigger as well. Scottish Renewables conducted a similar survey in Scotland, and even though that's a smaller supply chain, they were still supplying 2/3 of the supply chain for Scottish projects through the Scottish supply chain. And it sounds like from some of the presentations earlier that we've got similar levels in Wales as well, which is fantastic to hear. You've heard a lot about these projects. You probably can't see those. We looked at case studies from across the UK as part of the work that we did this year, just to show how that money is being spent more locally. So in Wales, we looked at Tidal Energy Limited, which we've heard about in far more detail than I'd be able to explain to you already. In Orkney, again, Gareth would know, obviously has talked far more about it than I'd be able to, but we looked at a company called Green Marine, who've diversified from fishing into wave and tidal energy, and there's some of the jobs that have been created in Orkney as the result of marine energy. I've actually got 300 plus on that slide, which unfortunately it sounds like it's gone down a bit to 240 from Gareth's presentation, which is concerning, but let's hope that goes up. And then finally, in the southwest, we looked at a fabrication company called AMP Falmouth, who've been involved in maritime heritage industries for decades and centuries, probably even. And they've diversified into developing wave energy devices. So they produced, fabricated both the Seatricity device and the Fred Olsen device that have gone into WaveHub and into FabTest. And in doing so, they used 37 different local supply chain companies. So you can see how even the use of one company at a high level is feeding down into the supply chain at a lower level, as we've seen with the other presentations. So the main thing I wanted to talk about to you is some work that we commissioned with Scottish Renewables from BVG Associates, looking at the supply chain capability across the UK and trying to identify some initiatives which would help to maximise the growth of the supply chain for the UK wave and tidal sector. And you probably can't see this list of words, so I'll read a few of them out. So they looked at companies working ports, utilities, fabrication specialists, vessel operations, cable suppliers, environmental consultants, installation contractors, technology developers, on and on. And they did that through a series of interviews with 26 different companies and also through an online survey. And what we really wanted to be sure they would capture was not just those companies that are already working in wave and tidal energy, but those that have the capability to diversify, but haven't taken the decision to invest in diversifying just yet. So we captured all of their views as well as their capability. So at a very high level, this is what BVG found. They looked at 12 different sub-elements, and they categorized the capability in the UK from red, red, amber and green effectively. And they found that there was scope within the UK supply chain to supply pretty much everything that you need to build a wave and tidal, wave or tidal project. And as we've seen, because most of the content has been supplied for the UK for the projects that we've had developed so far. And importantly, they found that those companies felt that they would be able to scale up their production as the wave and tidal demand grew and keep pace with that, but so long as they had the right sort of level of confidence that that market would be of a sufficient scale to be financially rewarding for them. So BVG identified the key export territories which we should be looking to in the UK or already are looking to. So there'll be no surprises here. So Canada and France were the two countries which were identified as, in the short term, having the most opportunities, followed by Japan, Korea, and the USA. And although BVG didn't rule out the potential to export large components, long distances, because this is already kind of happening in offshore wind. A lot of wind turbines are transported long distances. They focused on a number of areas which were particularly good for export, particularly high opportunities for export. So that was diverse device and component supply and intellectual property related to that, systems engineering, design, manufacture and integration, specialist skills and expertise, including in project development, and installation and operations management. And importantly, they identified that one of the ways to capture a big market share in that global export market is first of all by gaining early experience in the commercialization of wave and tidal energy. So by having an early domestic market and having that supplied predominantly by UK supply chain, companies will gather the experience that they need so that they can do well when they're pitching into international projects. And secondly, that we could improve the export credit arrangements in the UK to help these companies capture a bigger share of the global market. And importantly, we didn't just look at the capability as part of this study, we looked at what sorts of initiatives these companies felt would help them increase their investment in wave and tidal energy and growing their business. And I don't know if you can see these, but these are the list of priorities that came out of that questioning. And they're fundamentally around market visibility and visibility of a market of sufficient scale to get them interested. So although BVG looked at a number of different initiatives which could enable industry in other ways, the real focus was on the market. So that's the recommendations which we put forward to DEC as a result of this work were fundamentally around establishing an early domestic market and capturing market share through that. There's also a point on here around UK content targets, which is something that is difficult to do within the European Union, but we have found through my colleagues who work in offshore wind that the introduction of supply chain plans as part of the requirements for CFD applications has driven very useful conversations around procurement plans and sourcing a lot of the content locally. So that's something that we'd look to maybe explore in the future for wave and tidal as well. So in summary, the UK supply chain does have the capability to supply everything that's really needed for a wave or tidal wind farm, and these companies are already benefiting within the supply chain. And suppliers will invest in growing their business, but only if they've got the confidence that the market will be of sufficient scale to be interesting to them. The experience early on in the commercialization of the industry in the UK will help to capture a larger market share globally. And we think one of the best ways of doing that is to get long-term political commitment at a national and a local level within the UK for wave and tidal development at scale, and that will instill the confidence that's needed within the supply chain. And we've produced this report, which you probably can't see, but it's available on our website, as is the BVG assessment, which looks more detail at the capability. And we've put forward recommendations in this report, which we'll be continuing to develop with the Marine Energy Programme Board to hope that the next government that comes forward after the general election prioritises marine energy when it comes in. And finally, we are hosting the International Conference of Ocean Energy in the UK, in Scotland, Edinburgh, next February. And This is an international conference that's led by industry, and it's the first time it's come to the UK. We're seeing it as a really good opportunity to try and draw in the supply chain from other industries to re-engage them with marine energy. So we'd really like to see lots of you there. And that's me. Thank you.